Let's take a look at some other receptors. There are other cells, and instead of alpha-1 receptors, they have beta receptors. And the beta receptors that we talk about, well, we'll just call these beta. There's two types of beta receptors. The beta symbol is a B with like a long stick underneath it. So we think about beta-1 and we think about beta-2. If I give a beta-1 agonist or a beta-2 agonist, they're ringing different doorbells on cells and doing different things. Beta-1 and beta-2 affect the heart and the lungs. And the way to remember which one affects which is that we have one heart, that's beta-1, and we have two lungs. There's our lung, and that's beta-2. What do they do? Remember, beta-1 and beta-2 are part of the sympathetic nervous system, so they're what gets turned on when we see the bear and we have to react to it. So if you see a bear and you're trying to run away, or drop bear, or kangaroo, whatever you want to, because I'm down here in Australia, what do you want your heart to do? Well, you're going to want your heart to work harder. You're going to want it to work faster, and you're going to want it to work stronger, and you're going to want the electrical signals to travel faster. It's kind of like giving your heart a coffee. So when beta-1 agonists hit the outside of the cell, and there's a reaction inside the cell, the reaction's like giving coffee. Well, we speed up. One of the side effects that we don't really like is also very similar to coffee, is that the more beta-1 agonists that you give, the more irritable the cells get. And if you make the cells too irritable, especially the cells in the heart where beta-1 is working, then they can start firing off really weird and you can start running into a whole bunch of problems. We give adrenaline, again, as our beta-1 agonist. There are drugs that work more specifically as beta-1 agonists, but we don't really have a specific beta-1 agonist. We use adrenaline if we want to speed up the heart. And then we're using adrenaline for its beta-1 effects. It'll also have alpha-1 effects, which turns out to be kind of a good thing, because if we're giving adrenaline because somebody's heart is going too slow and their blood pressure is too low, it does two great things. It constricts their blood vessels to raise their blood pressure, and it speeds up their heart and increases the strength of contraction, inotropy and chronotropy of the heart, so that we get a stronger output. So tighter vessels, stronger output, that's exactly what we want. It's like the perfect pre-hospital drug. You don't want to give too much, because if you give too much and tighten up the blood vessels too much and increase the blood pressure too much, they can have a stroke, which is obviously not what we want to induce in our patients. And if we give them too much beta-1 stimulation and the heart gets too irritable, then we can start getting into weird electrical dysrhythmias, and you can actually see those happening on the monitor. Let's talk about one more thing that beta-2 does. We've talked about how there are beta-2 receptors in the lungs. There's beta-2 receptors somewhere else in the body, and those beta-2 receptors are also very important. There's a type of cell inside our body, throughout our body, and they're called mast cells. And mast cells are a part of our immune system, and they have a very important function. I like to think of mast cells as landmines that are distributed throughout our body. So when a foreign pathogen comes into our body and the alarms are set off, then one of the things that happens is these mast cells explode. The physiological term for that is they degranulate. So they actually break apart, and a lot of the chemical bombs that are inside the mast cells go out into the body and have a whole bunch of effects. The biggest effect that these chemicals have are to promote inflammation. So we say that what's inside the mast cells are inflammatory mediators, drugs that mediate the inflammation process, histamines and leukotrienes and a whole bunch of different types of chemicals that have the net effect of making our body get inflamed. One of the ways that these mast cells work is if they're triggered off for whatever reason, they can just be triggered off and then they degranulate and we get our inflammatory mediators. There's another system that really makes them explode too, and sometimes way too much. The mast cells have the ability to recognize, this is a metaphor obviously, but to recognize the footprints of various foreign invaders. So if an invader comes in and the molecule brushes against the mast cells or activates the immune system, and the immune system recognizes this invader, the immune system says, I'm going to remember this invader for next time. And if they come, I'll know that they're an enemy right away, and I'll just explode all the landmines so that all the inflammatory mediators get out there. The way I remember that in my brain is that it's like the immune system memorizes the footprints of these foreign invaders. And as soon as that footprint hits down again, as soon as it lands in the body, it goes and activates all the alarms and everything goes crazy. The mechanism for recognizing those footprints is an immunoglobulin called immunoglobulin E. And immunoglobulin E is the little thing that recognizes the footprint. So the first time something bumps again IgE, it says, I'm going to remember you. And it goes, and the IgE attaches to the mast cells, and it says, you know what, I'm just going to stay here. And if I see that footprint again, I'm just going to make you degranulate. And all the inflammatory mediators are going to go all over the place. In a limited amount, having our mast cells degranulate is good for us because it helps us, you know, fight infections off. And that's a good thing. It activates the white blood cells, the macrophages that come and eat up the foreign invaders. It dilates blood vessels so that the macrophages can get out, and fluid can get out, and lymph drainage and all sorts of good stuff happens. But if we do too much, the mast cells can actually push us into a potentially fatal problem. If you detonate a few landmines, that's great. That's great. It kills the enemy. But if you detonate like all of them or way too many of them, then you're destroying the landscape and destroying your own troops as well. So we don't want the mast cells to go too crazy. And they do go too crazy sometimes. Anaphylaxis is a reaction where the mast cells are degranulating too much. So how can we stop these mast cells from degranulating? Well, it turns out, I'm glad you asked, that they have beta 2 receptor sites on them. And if beta 2 agonists hit these mast cells, then they tend to degranulate less. How can we hit these beta 2 receptor sites? Well, we can use salbutamol, which is beta 2 specific, or we can get out the heavy baseball bat and we can use adrenaline, which is why we use adrenaline or epinephrine in what are often called EpiPens. And an EpiPen is used when a foreign body comes in, stimulates too many of the mast cells to degranulate, we get too big a reaction, we get histamine coming out of the mast cells, and that's why we get the little urticaria that we see with anaphylactic reaction, and we get the airway shutting down, just basically people start to die from anaphylaxis. So we give them beta 2 agonist, or we give them just a straight sympathomimetic medic, which in our case is adrenaline, put it in a muscle, put it in an IV vein, whatever we want to do. But we get those that inotrope in there so that it stimulates the beta 2 on the mast cell and it stabilizes the mast cell so that it doesn't degranulate too much.